The Belfort Group will do whatever lies in our power to spread and distribute this report worldwide and bring it to the attention of key responsibles and influential people with a conscience towards humanity. You don't find very much of them. But by the time that New World Order will have been forgotten, as a quote, we hope that global awareness will still be remembered. For this very important task of commenting this report and reviewing it, we needed to find an academic of undisputed reputation, familiar with the subject and the problematics, and especially willing to comment freely and objectively in a critical way. I believe that you understand how difficult it is to find such a person. You will therefore also understand how delighted and grateful we are to introduce this expert in aviation and space technology from the Technische Universiteit Delft in the Netherlands. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Koen Vermeeren.
Thank you very much. It's an honor for me to be here with so many of you. A few weeks ago, Peter Vreke asked me to review this 300 or more page report. And of course, first I declined because I said, well, I'm not an expert. And then he said, well, there are no experts, basically, not in the open at least. And because I tend to be a bit open-minded. I am not here on behalf of our university, but I do work there as an aerospace engineer. So at least the trailing business is part of my space, my workspace. But I also organize a lot of lectures out of the box for the Delft University, and well, this is typically out of the box. So I said, okay, I will do it. I'm going to sit down because I have to do a lot of reading. This is scientific stuff, so that means 300 pages. I won't give them to you, but I will give you some of the pages. And Peter asked me to be as objective as possible. I think that is an impossibility, because you can never be objective about anything, but I will try to be as much as I can. It is not that I was unfamiliar with the chemtrail discussion, because we have a lot of first-year students in Delft studying aeronautical engineering, about 500 a year, so that's a lot. And there are always maybe between 5 to 15 students who ask questions to teachers. And at first you think, well, okay, it's quite normal. And then you start thinking about it again. And it seems to be more difficult than at first sight. Okay, so this is the report, Case Orange it is called, for reasons that I will come back to you on. Contrail science, its impact on climate and weather manipulation programs conducted by the United States and its allies. The authors are unknown. That is always a bit dubious, as you can understand, because, well, you cannot talk to the scientists involved, and that makes this quite a special job. The introduction and the evaluation of the report are on my account. The rest of the 5 chapters are from this report by the unknown authors. Let's start with the introduction. We heard it today already a few times. We have got shifting baselines. That means that I'm of another generation, and many of you are, that remember that there are blue skies. Every now and then you could see an aircraft with a trail, which we find quite normal. But usually people are with their heads to the ground in their own two-dimensional space, and they don't look up. But if you do, you see more and more space like this. And it worried me too. I have no explanations to our students about these phenomena. So that is important to realize. Well, this, of course, you all know. If you look at them from a scientific point of view, the first thing a scientist does is trying to explain something. Because I'm smart and my students are not as smart yet, so I have to give them answers to questions. But if you ask most scientists, honestly, they cannot answer all your questions, which is just a truth to keep in mind. So this looks normal. Maybe it is, maybe it's not. On the internet, there's a lot of discussion, and you all recognize these pictures. By the way, I cannot say that there are toxins in these barrels. That's not what I've investigated. I do know from experience that these barrels are used for shifting water down the plane in test flights to simulate movements of the center of gravity around the aircraft for control and steering testing. So that's quite normal. This is not a conspiracy, in all cases at least. So if you look at these contrails, of course we live in a world of Photoshop. As an expert, I cannot say that these things are wrong. If I see them myself, then I'm a first-hand eyewitness, I can say something about it. But it is not normal. What you see here is absolutely not as it should be. The same goes for this pattern here, which was seen above the Netherlands, and not only the Netherlands, of course, we've seen many pictures already, also above the Northern Netherlands a few weeks ago. And they are often explained as holding patterns. Well, holding patterns are given to aircraft who have to hold before they can land. Well, in this part of the country, we cannot have this many aircraft holding, and especially on the altitudes that they are holding, you should not be able to see chemtrails in a perfectly blue sky. So these are strange phenomena as well. Okay, that in mind, I'm going to the report, and the report is divided in a few chapters, as you can see here. We'll go through them all. Contrails then. We have known them ever since men started to fly at high altitude. And this picture here is famous for the B-17 bombers in the Second World War. And they didn't like it. The pilots didn't like these trails because they made enemy fighters gave enemy fighters an easier job to track them down. So they didn't like that. The question that came to my mind immediately, what is a persistent contrail? Is that based on its length? And sometimes the report says between 20 to 30 miles. Based on time, from seconds to minutes, or maybe even to hours, or based on the dimensions, so not only the length of the contrail, but also, after a few hours, the width of the contrail. So if you want to discuss this in a scientific way, you will have to set up standards to discuss this. Contrails are a difficult phenomenon. We saw that from the previous speaker as well. We don't really know that much about them, at least not in the open debate. So we know they depend on temperature, on local humidity, about the composition of the exhaust gases, aerosols, be it natural aerosols or the aerosols from the engine, wind conditions, etc., etc. So there's a lot of variables which make this scientifically a very difficult exercise. So, temperature and relative humidity, and on average we say, well, contrails can become visible above 8 to 8,500 meters. And that is the same range in which the cirrus clouds are found. We have distrails, which means that when an aircraft flies through a cloud, it may alter as well the circumstances locally. And we have seen this also with the previous speakers, the vortex from the wingtip, which is, to my knowledge, not dependent on temperature. It's because of the very low pressure. And the low pressure makes condensation, facilitates condensation. And they just evaporize again after a few seconds or minutes. And you see this beautiful vortex when an aircraft, especially when it starts landing, which creates an enormous vortex at the wingtips, that you can sometimes see these beautiful curly clouds. Supersonic flight as well, shock waves, also a pressure differential, which is very abrupt, will create sometimes something which you could call a small and not persistent cloud. We also know that chemtrails exist because we do spraying. We do spraying for crops, for example, and we know that they have been spraying also for military purposes. So chemtrails is nothing new. We know about it. Also, we use them for fun. And I don't know if you've ever seen these guys. It's incredible what they do. And they increase the show by adding some smoke and colors. And probably this is done by a technology with powder, colored powder, whatever. So we know that it's possible. One of the nastiest chemtrail records, of course, is the Agent Orange. This report is called Case Orange as well. I think this refers to this quite dreadful event in Vietnam during the war, in which no less than 42 million liters has been sprayed out over at least 10% of Vietnam, Laos and Cambodia, killing a lot of plants, animals and damaging humans as well. We also know that chemtrails is being done throughout the world in some countries like China and Russia because they don't want bad weather during parades and Olympic Games, for example. We know that Moscow seeds clouds to avoid too much snow in the winter in Moscow, because they say, well, it costs too much to clean up the streets from snow, so let's try to keep the snow out of town. It doesn't always work. Everybody who keeps track of the news knows that sometimes it gets even worse, like in China, when Peking, Beijing, had the worst snow in ages because of this seeding procedure. Well, you can buy a sunny weather for $6,000 in Russia. Okay, then the odd event of weatherman red report stating that some of the radar images that they have on television are not created by natural phenomenon, but by cloud seeding by military aircraft. The one in Germany in 2005 is exemplary, which started over Holland. It's quite big, by the way. It's more than 200 to 300 kilometers. And the weather report in America over California, showing the green areas there, in which this weatherman even reports to the audience that it's chaff, and chaff is bits of aluminium. And he says as well, I know what it is because I've done it myself, something like that. So this is happening. It's not a hoax. It just happens. Chaff, by the way, is used in military aircraft to divide maybe some rockets launched towards you to distract them. Okay, effects of man-made contrails. Meteorologists usually deny the effects of these contrails, probably because they don't know much about it, so it makes it very difficult for them to give any comments about it. But investigations have been done as early as the 1950s, in the 1980s, and also nowadays, I presume. So we could say that the contrail knowledge is quite poor. Investigation, as I showed you earlier, is quite difficult. And the only opportunity in which you can do an experiment without any aircraft was just after the 9/11 attacks, in which there was a window of 3 days without any aircraft, and as well, recently, with the volcanic eruptions. Those data are being processed, so probably we'll hear from that quite soon. But from these 9/11 post experiments, Travis and other scientists say that it shows a significant influence. So, a contrail is basically a chemtrail, even if it's a contrail, because chemistry, everything you see is chemistry. So, but the usual combustion gas from an aircraft engine consists of CO2, water, all kinds of nitric oxides, a bit of sulfur, and the aerosols, which we refer to quite a lot when it comes to chemtrails, soot and other kinds of unburned hydrocarbons. So that's nothing new there. I do know from my experience that aircraft engines over the years have become more and more efficient. And that also states the report that they say that, well, about nearly 100% of the fuel is combusted into all those natural combustion gases. So the soot part is really very limited. There shouldn't be much in there. But on idle conditions, so you have a very low force from the engine, you even have 1% of the fuel that is not combusted, so that gives a bit of more pollution. So the engines become more efficient, so more mileage to the gallon, better noise properties, so reduction of noise, and also, therefore, less pollution. That's what we know. So with respect to the aerosols, they should only be less compared to the time in which I grew up. Another thing goes for the military aircraft, because they use better fuels than the average jet fuels for civil aviation, because they have to perform all around in very dry conditions, in very cold or very hot conditions. So their fuels are added with all kinds of additives to make them better for all these circumstances. So those combustion gases should contain more pollutants, more aerosols of all kinds of substances, which we don't know because they're patented. Another thing is about the military fleets. Most of these aircraft are quite old and they are using old engine technology, which means they are more pollutant than modern civil aviation aircraft. That having said, we are looking at the effects of contrails on the climate. So we know about cirrus. Cirrus are ice crystals, usually above 8 kilometers. And it states that 30% of the sky can be clouded with cirrus on average. It's usually less, but it's possible that 30% is clouded. What do we know about cirrus? Well, we know that the Earth absorbs heat, but radiates heat out again. And immediate modulator is the cloud coverage. So the cloud, being white, may radiate air light from the sun out before it hits the surface of the Earth, but also the radiation that has hit the Earth may bounce back because of the clouds. So it works both ways. And the thing is that it is very difficult to say which of these two wins. So is cloud coverage helpful to reduce heating up, or is it not helpful but detrimental? And that debate is still going on. We simply are not sure about it, not in all conditions. And because the contrails are such a big phenomenon, especially in certain parts of the world, we should make another sort of nomenclatura, category in our World Meteorological Organization. So we should deal with it. We cannot just ignore it or say, well, it's not nice or it's nice to see. We have to take it as a serious phenomenon. Exhaust aerosols are nuclei, we saw that already, for water to form ice crystal, and they create the visibility of the trail. So that's the ice crystal that we see. And then we can have either persistent or short-lived contrails. We have seen this already. There are some investigations that are looking to cirrus formation compared to what is already there in the natural circumstances. And we can see that, especially over Europe and the United States, these man-made cirrus patterns are seriously contributing to the cirrus clouds. Well, several studies are discussed in the report, and usually the discussion goes towards that cirrus is quite negative for climate. These two guys, Whiteleg and Cambridge of the Stockholm Environmental Institute, state that in general aviation poses a threat to several stakeholders on a global chain scale, affecting the whole ecosystem, and regional and local and community and personal scales. So it affects basically everyone on this planet and also all ecosystems. So they say it's quite an important issue and we should deal with it. There is not much action going on in starting investigations on man-made cirrus. It's even worse because international aviation is left out of the Kyoto Protocol, which means that nobody really has to look at it. And that's, of course, not a very good idea if it's so important. The UK government states that aircraft emissions, if they are taken into account, they will not be able to meet the targets of Kyoto, which means 60% reduction in greenhouse gases by 2050. So they even acknowledge that this is something that should be done immediately. In the United States, then, talks between the Federal Aviation Authority and the Environmental Agency have ended without any results, because they only were talking about a voluntary program to reduce pollution and particle matter of aircraft. So no obligation there to change some behavior. In Germany, DLR suggested to lower cruise altitude to at least with 6,000 feet, which means to get lower than on average where the contrails are originated. But doing that means more friction, so more fuel consumption. So it's a very difficult debate to solve this problem. But they acknowledge that contrails are a problem. The only problem is, in general, the report states, that we don't openly discuss this. Sort of, it is kind of a taboo. And they claim that it is probably the lobby of airliners losing money, and everybody who knows the airline business knows that they don't make much money to begin with. So who pays for that all? And that was also this morning debated. Well, the Travis guys, after 9/11, only a three-day period, saw an increase of temperature of 1.1 degrees centigrade, which is quite substantial. That means that no flying, no man-made contrails, means a difference, if you look over all the years, of more than 1 degree. And you know the debate in on global climate change is in the order of 1 or 2 degrees. So this is important. It's very significant. After flying started again after 9/11, the temperature went immediately down with 0.8 degrees. So it shows that it's important. Climate gauge, you all heard about it. Scientists manipulating the weather and climate data. So what does that mean, the report states? Does it even exist, global warming, or not? What are the exact parameters? Nobody knows. In 1995, the IPCC, which is the International Panel for Climate Change, they predicted the increased influence of jet aircraft emissions is not realized. And the report states then that the aircraft emissions do influence climate, but maybe not to the extent predicted. So the cooling down effect by contrails outweighs the global warming potential. Additives to the fuel may be added to counter global warming, or both. And this is one of the key issues of the report. Then contrails and precipitation. Well, we've seen from the previous speaker that we need some conditions, which means moisture. Cold air contains less humidity than warm air. We need aerosols, nuclei, for the formation of ice crystals. But also, the droplets must be able to come down. And normally you have water droplets or ice crystals, and they just float around in the air. And they must get heavier, otherwise they just stay there. Well, we know that man-made contrails, that in jet engines we have nuclei. Maybe not so many, but we do have them. We have a temperature drop that could decrease the precipitation. But still, there is a lot of debate going on, so very little conclusive results. An important discussion in the report is about a professor of the University of Jerusalem who has been studying aerosols in the atmosphere. And he comes to very important conclusions because he says increase in aerosols first leads to more precipitation. So the more aerosols you put in the sky, then you get more rain, basically. But if you go even higher in aerosols in the atmosphere, it becomes drier. That makes aerosol emission a sort of a button for climate, well, geoengineers, to control weather, make it drier or make it wetter. This will come back later as well. Well, Professor Rosenberg continues then that we can thus manipulate the weather by using aerosols. We can lower or higher precipitation rates. Only we should have the technology to do so, and well, the reports claim that this technology is already there. So we only need a scientific base, which means a reliable matrix for aerosols ingredients versus field conditions. That means if you want to change the weather, you have to have the right parameters and the right ways to do it. Otherwise, you don't get your wanted result. They need an engineering system, well, preferably for low cost, of course. And you need some sponsoring parties. That means parties that want to pay for this kind of weather modification. And of course, if you want to pay for something, you have a motive, you have a reason why you want to do it. Something the report also claims is that the discussion of contrails is not held because if you look at the difference in using the word chemtrail on the internet, for example, Google and blogs and images, videos, news and forums, you can see that in the regular news, chemtrails are never discussed. While on the internet, especially in blogs, but also in Google and in images and videos, the increase on chemtrails is enormous. This means that the chemtrail discussion is only regarded as a conspiracy theory. And so everything to do with contrails or chemtrails, whatever, is not discussed. And as a scientist, you shouldn't do, and well, you shouldn't be part of any discussion. That means that you don't get any support from scientists. That's basically the reason. You don't get any interest by politicians and even by environmental organizations. Well, also they have a problem in addressing this problem. Basically, the general public doesn't want to do anything with the knowledge that is available because the report that I've investigated is only dealing with knowledge that can be found by anyone on the internet. So it's out in the open, it's not even concealed. A small history then of geoengineering for anyone who likes it. The report says to make it easier for people to see that there is a lot of discussion going on, a lot of testing being done, a lot of geoengineering being done in the recent past, and I'm talking about the period of at least 60 years. So we have seen some large-scale testing by Nikola Tesla, his name was mentioned before. In the World War II, there was the first atmospheric seeding. After the Second World War, the Cold War started, and we had a lot of Russian and American cloud seeding programs going on. In 1996 was an important study done by some of the high-level military in the United States, who came up with a report, which is an unclassified report, so anybody can load it down, weather as a force multiplier, owning the weather in 2025. There's a whole series of reports, strategic reports, about the year 2025. And of course, ever since we know that we are doing something with the climate, we now have the necessity of geoengineering for planetary survival. I'm not going to discuss all these things because you can all find them on the internet. I will just show you that Tesla has been working on extremely important inventions. We know that there is atmospheric seeding for military purposes. I've shown you earlier in 2005, but already in 1943, people were using chaff, aluminium parts, to mess with enemy radar. So that is nothing new there. I can't answer your question, but I will do that later on. In 1945 to 1915, there was Operation Cirrus. And the word says it, it was to do something with some kind of cirrus cloud formation. And that means seeding small ice particles at high altitude to create cirrus. The experiment was done to create mitigation of tycoons, so softening the devastating work of tycoons. Well, that's a beneficial way of changing the weather, of course. But something went terribly wrong somewhere, so the typhoon wasn't mitigated, it was even worse. And so there was lawsuits and stuff like that, and so they kept it quiet, because they didn't want any responsibility for that. 62 Operation Storm Fury, well, the world says it as well. Operation Popeye, very important in Vietnam. I've already shown you there. So the monsoon there was extended by 30 to 45 days in order to weaken enemy troop movements. And there is also this weather modification report, which is basically a Senate hearing about this Operation Popeye, which you can find on the internet. And you just have all these guys talking about it, whether it's buying a loaf of bread at your local groceries. And that is somewhere in the 1960s. A lot of people don't know, but the report also describes that after the Chernobyl disaster, this cloud of fallout radioactive material was about to reach Moscow. And of course, the Russian government didn't want the people in Moscow to become sick, so they seeded the clouds. So this radioactive fallout came down on other populations. Who are still not really pleased with that. This is also openly discussed on websites and in the media. Another issue, which is also related to a conspiracy theory, is about what do we do with the ionosphere? Can we put a lot of extra energy into our Earth atmosphere in certain layers so that we can do something with it, modify the weather, or use it for military purposes? Well, already for a long time, the United States and Russia have been using this kind of technology to change properties of the ionosphere for communication, but maybe also for weather control. This is openly debated, and you can also find lots of things on the internet. And ever since, we have built probably at least 10 known ionosphere heaters, who are usually called research facilities, around the world, 4 in the US, 1 in Norway, which is operated by the German Max Planck Institute, and 5 Russians. And the one shown here is a Norwegian ionosphere heater, HARP kind of experimental facility. So this is about the HARP program, which is drawn up by the US Air Force, US Navy, some civil partners, and some other military parties. Which claims to be a civil study to the aurora borealis, but everybody knows that all kinds of activities can be done in manipulating our atmosphere. This year, this facility should be able to heat about 1 gigawatt, which is 1 million times 1 million watts, into the atmosphere. Well, when this came out, the Russians were not amused because they find it quite threatening. And the report states that about the environmental impact statement was set about 1,000 times higher than what the Russians deemed safe. So there's a lot of potential in this machine. It refers to a US patent. Peter already mentioned several times that, that there are a lot of patents just openly traceable on the internet, which in which you can see what kind of known technologies or technologies to be developed are available. Okay, the history of geoengineering then. The US patent that I mentioned is owed by Arco Power Technologies. And the report found out, also through the internet, that this small company that initially had 15 patents with regard to weather modification was the initial HAARP contractor. But it was then bought out to E-Systems and later on to Raytheon Corporation. And Raytheon is a supplier, a preferred supplier for US aerospace and defense industry. And the report also said that Raytheon initially wanted to have the HAARP, but they were not allowed to have it. But with a certain detour, it came again into their hands. And you can find these kinds of patents. They're very interesting to read, in which you can see not only in the abstract what it, what the patient really does, but also some nice, interesting schematic drawings about what is going on. 1 gigawatt. It's quite a lot. Another patent then, a method of generating an electromagnetic radiation within the latitude that encompasses Alaska. So this patent, even in its patent, refers to a latitude in the world, a place in the world, where Alaska is. And, well, of course, there is HAARP. The reason that they do it in remote places is because when you put so much energy up in the air and you fly through it, well, you all kinds of distortions you will have in your air traffic. So you can't have it only in remote places. Northern Russia and Northern Norway and Northern United States. Well, the conclusion that they give in the report is that both sides and others like China have tested and used military and civil applications for weather modification since as early as the Second World War. Okay, there's a lot in the report about atomic testing as well. Basically, atomic testing in the atmosphere also creates electromagnetic pulses, which are basically a lot of energy coming free in the atmosphere, and that also does a lot of things to the atmosphere. Changing the weather, probably changing enemy electronics as well, etc., etc. Okay, then the report, an important report, I mentioned it earlier. Owning the weather in 2025. It says that concepts, capabilities and technologies the US will require to remain the dominant air and space force in the future. So, the report says, let there be no mistake. The United States want to keep their dominance in the world. And they're willing to do that at a high cost and with all means. The disclaimer says, it is from the beginning an unclassified report, which is quite special because they like to keep things to themselves, usually when it comes to these kinds of things, that a fictional representation of future scenarios and the viewpoints do not reflect of the United States Air Force, the Department of Defense and US government. I think that's possible. In this report, you have two tables, and one just states that the report says that if we have the technology, then we can degrade enemy forces by having more rain, for example, by creating flood lines, by reducing PGM. I don't know what that is at this moment. Decrease comfort level and morale. So that's basically Operation Popeye, but then with other technology. They can enhance storms. They can deny operations, all kinds of things that you want to do to inflict upon the enemy. The other table says we can enhance our friendly forces. So there is a lot of things that we can use this technology for to make it to our own military a bit easier. To maintain visibility, to maintain comfort levels, to choose battle space environment, etc., etc. Okay. This important report also says that current demographic, economic, and environmental trends will create global stresses that provide the impetus necessary for many countries or groups to turn weather modification ability into capability. In the United States, weather modification will likely become part of the national security policy with both domestic and international applications. And our government will pursue such a policy depending on its interest at various levels. And if you look at what the report states as possible effects of weather manipulation, you know, in the broad of the sense, then these measures are extreme and it is possible to change the weather globally. And it says, Further on, the essential ingredient of the weather modification system is the set of intervention techniques used to modify the weather. The number of specific intervention methodologies is limited only by the imagination. But with few exceptions, they involve infusing either energy or chemicals into the meteorological process in the right way, at the right place, and the right time. Make no mistakes. The roadmaps shown here, the document is from 1996, and we want to owe the weather in 2025. You can see here that, for example, they're quite good right now at fog and cloud modification. That becomes more and more obsolete if they increase other capabilities, like storm modification, artificial weather, precipitation modification, etc. So this is sort of a roadmap where you want to go. Another one says here, which is quite important, that the chemical, it says chem and adv, and read chemicals and aerospace delivery vehicles, which are now not at the baseline, but are already somewhere, and we now live 2010, so they are up to 30-40% maybe, will be increased over the coming years. So they actually acknowledge that these things are already going on. Okay, human activity influences the Earth climate. We can agree on that. We still don't know exactly how. The climate gate, inconvenient truth, Al Gore, there's a lot of criticism. And of course, Al Gore is in the meantime a billionaire in cap and trade. Well, we know that climate has become big business. The report states that it is logical to assume that our quality of life is in great danger and immediate action is necessary to safeguard the planet. I'll leave that to the report. The report mentions an array and certain kinds of means to counteract global warming. For example, by iron fertilization, the throwing out of iron particles over the oceans. That means that there is going to be more plankton getting CO2 out of the sky. Chemical buffering. Both of these we are not going to discuss, but we are going to discuss geoengineering. And then we come to patent 5386 of the Hughes Aircraft Company, which has 18 claims. One of them is seeding aluminium oxide in the stratosphere, or thorium oxide. Refractory Welsbach material, which is also refractory materials consisting of several chemicals. Particle size is mentioned, and the dispersed between 7 to 13 kilometers. So this is in the patent. Well, Hughes Aircraft Company, who got this patent in the first place, is now owned by Raytheon again. And this is, you can just find it on the internet, it's fascinating stuff. It says that spraying method, although not firmly specified, described in the background of the invention, stating that one technique proposed to seed the metallic particles was to add the tiny particles to the fuel of jet airlines, so that the tiny particles would be emitted from the jet engine while the airline was at its cruising altitude. So it just plainly states that this is the way to do it. Okay, coming back to Mitchell and Finnegan then, in a report from 2009. And the paper is called Modification of Cirrus Clouds to Reduce Global Warming. They state that the seeding material comprised of a pressed composite of reagent bismuth metal, aluminium and gilsonite, I don't know what it is, natural hydrocarbon, could be either dissolved or suspended in the jet fuel of commercial airliners and later burned with the fuel to create seeding aerosol. This method is applicable to civil aviation. Any civil aircraft can be installed with this kind of material and nobody would know or have to know it. They go on stating that alternatively the mix could be directly injected into the hot engine exhaust, so that's after the fuel is burned, which should vaporize the seeding material, allowing to condense as aerosol in the jet contrail. So, all patented. It looks like this. The engines from the older engines from AWACS aircraft and the KC-135, which is a tanker aircraft, they already have spraying pots, and they are described in another patent. And the patent is here describing that contrail generation apparatus for powder contrails, for maximum radiation scattering ability, 85% metallic particles, and these particles and these contrails should sustain for periods up to 1 to 2 weeks, which is quite an extensive life. So, the logical conclusion from the previous knowledge is, states the report, that cirrus clouds have significant influence on temperature and precipitation. Combined with strategic plans and scientific studies, it is a matter of time before climate modification using cirrus will be used for peaceful or military purposes, if it is not already ongoing. Are you still with me? This is real science, guys. This is boring, boring. Okay. If temperatures would rise 2 to 3 degrees centigrade, some scientists predict massive weather problems. This is stated in the report. Recently, 5 economists, Nobel laureates, just before Copenhagen, proclaim that climate engineering is the most cheap and rapid response. So we're not going to look at the cause of the problem. No, we're going to fix it by climate engineering. And they have an old table with ratings for several ways of doing this. And they rate that stratospheric aerosol insertion is very good. That's science, scientists saying that. So, in May 2010, this report claims that climate control programs, controlled by military but approved by governments, are silently implemented in order to avoid the worst-case scenario of the climate change. Two basic instruments we have: temperature control through artificial clouding and manipulation of the ionosphere through ionospheric heaters. They anticipate that around the world there is lots of cooperation going on, of which the general public does not know. Just a few more slides before I go to the conclusions and the recommendations. The same guys in October 2009, so that's just half a year ago, state that with the delivery process already existing, this geoengineering approach may be less expensive than other proposed approaches. It implies that the method for widespread spraying of metal particles through commercial and military aviation is already in place and may even have been in place for a long time. Approval of the patent suggests that extensive testing has already been done, for example, by the US aircraft company. Combined with possible secret order issues in the name of national security, certain patents may even be confiscated by US government, thus the public would not have knowledge of it, but not of all. For Europe, and now we're coming to the legal aspects of climate modeling. For Europe, clouds, man-made clouds using metallic particles, created in one country and drifting into another country, may violate laws. The example from Germany was one of them. Yet if one does not know that this is happening, there is no problem, of course. Yeah. In Russia and China, spraying is legal. They do it all the time if they deem it necessary. In the United States, spraying is legal according to public law. There is public law that just states we are allowed to spray on our populace. In the United States, you have the Space Preservation Act proposal of 2001. The first one was rejected in April 2002 after some unfavorable executive comments from the Department of Defense. In the unrevised proposal, there were statements on a ban on exotic space weapons. For example, a ban on ultra-low frequency weapons, a ban on environmental and climate weapons, and a ban specifically stating chemtrails. The only existing official document mentioning the phenomenon chemtrails was this Preservation Act. But then they altered it and the word chemtrail was removed. You can also find these documents on the internet. I cannot say if they're genuine. I didn't go into the depth of the legislative library in the United States, for example, but many websites are stating these documents. You can find at the bottom somewhere the word chemtrails. What about safety then? Safety and health aspects. For health and environmental issues, the present report only refers to the literature with regard to aerotoxic syndrome, which is a syndrome that flight crews experience above average from normal people when they are exposed longer times in the cabin from bleed air, that is the air that is coming into the cabin to refresh the air, which is drawn from the engines, from the part of the cold part of the engines, but they have contaminations with hydraulic fluids, engine oils, and maybe some fuel gases. So these crews are usually more sick from these kinds of gases. Military aircraft. The report is quite frank on their views about military aircraft. I already mentioned that, because a military aircraft, especially when there's a war going on, and there are several, they contribute substantially to flight movements throughout the world. Many military aircraft fly under less strict conditions, so they are bypassing laws that are applicable to civil aviation. So they can pollute much more than a normal KLM or other aircraft. They therefore contribute more to the potential part of the hazardous air pollutants. And the report says that they should be banned. Okay. Now I come to the conclusions and recommendations of the report. And then I have my own evaluation, because Peter asked me what I found of this report in scientific way. First conclusion is that the manipulation of climate through modification of cirrus is neither a hoax nor a conspiracy theory, but currently the best option considered by decision makers to counter global warming. The impact of production of artificial cirrus on temperature and precipitation patterns is supported by adequate hard scientific evidence. Second, the ambition of the US is to control the weather by 2025, both for civil and military purposes, offensive and defensive strategies. This report shows a proven track record. Third, the technology to organize spraying actions on a global scale is widely available. Both civil and military aviation is used for that purpose. The mix containing metal oxides and chemical components can either be dispersed through special design pots or directly incorporated into the jet fuel. The research paper is well documented in this respect. Four, since the patents are owned by the main defense contractor for the United States Armed Forces, Raytheon, or the US Department of Defense itself, and given the history record of these companies and the government agency, it is obvious that current climate manipulation programs are organized and directed by the US government. Five, the spraying actions in Europe are only possible with prior approval and intense coordination on top-level government levels and industry on executive levels. The general public is intentionally kept unaware of the existence of such projects. And six, last one, although the spraying actions may be considered legal, these actions may have a potential detrimental effect on health. There is sufficient scientific evidence available in this research paper to support this thesis. Then the report comes with some recommendations. That not enough knowledge is available and scientific study is hampered by the conspiracy context of contrails. Therefore, they suggest to start a new investigation from scratch. This should be a scientific study looking at old research and pending patents, looking into associations from academia to political and, for example, IPCC, including military that are using climate control as a weapon. The new investigation should contain experiments. And we should start by using other words, like cloud seeding, geoengineering, and weather manipulation, because they are still accepted, while chemtrails is an unaccepted word. Then, artificial cirrus clouds should be classified as a separate cloud genus by the World Meteorological Organization. Additional scientific research with the effects on nature and public health on this subject should be considered. Results, whatever the outcome, should be made public. It is unacceptable that the AWACS aircraft fleet under NATO that operates under a Luxembourg civil registration without complying with civil aviation regulations, which is a flagrant violation of the law, and this should be corrected in the very near future. Given the very unfavorable engine emission ratios of this aircraft, retrofitting of these engines should be considered as soon as practical. 3. When considering a legal case, it is better to sue an industrial group such as Raytheon rather than a governmental agency. It is clear for us that the responsibility of Raytheon in this respect is far-reaching, with the creation of a monopoly in climate modeling and weather as a geoengineering or military instrument. If possible, an international ban should be placed on such weapons. 4. Although the existence of weather modification projects have been illustrated in an adequate way in this research paper, it is now the duty of a serious politician on any level to make inquiries to the government for public release of these spraying schemes through aviation. It is mandatory that such statement should include the reason why such operations are conducted. It is not an option to hide behind the motive of national security. This should be 5, but it is 3. It's just a copy of something else. Sorry. Okay. Coming back to what my ideas are about this report. Of course, in my years as a scientist, I have read many reports, although not on this subject. And I can say that the normal scientific report build-up is used. So it's starting with nomenclatura, summary, chapters, conclusion, recommendations, and in this case, a lot of appendices. And I've seen that this report uses a lot of verifiable references. So to my opinion, this is a good report. It's a proper investigation, although most, if not all, the information is in the public domain. So we can verify it. Many resources, some witness accounts are in the report. I don't put them here on display because there was no identity given. And also the report itself is anonymous. So that is one of the first things that should change if we want to have an open scientific debate on this. Well, the conclusions that I've just given to you are well backed up by the research itself. They are usually brought in a very objective and non-emotional way without much exaggeration, to my opinion. There is some reading between the lines, and you can see that the guys or girls that made up this report have a lot more knowledge than they are sharing in this report, and sometimes it's difficult to keep within the constraint of their own report, so they elaborate a little bit on it, and they are connecting dots that we cannot see. Except for us, of course, because we are a bit familiar with the subject. So they didn't bring all the ongoing discussion into the research, like the possible motives that that Mr. Murphy was showing about chemtrails being used for other purposes besides geoengineering, which might be valid, but should be substantiated with a lot of other sources and evidence. I think the recommendations are valid, and I could be supportive of those recommendations. I think they could have even recommended much more than that, but I think this is quite good for the purpose of this report. Some of the skeptics will be saying in the future that the evidence brought in this report is to be described as circumstantial. But I think the recommendations and the conclusions are based on sound logic. As I told you before, I don't think, and a lot of people around me think that as well, that the contrails shouldn't last that long if they were just the plain contrails like we used to see. Also, the health issue could be, and maybe should be, more extensively discussed, because only discussing the health issues of aircrew is not enough, to my opinion, and in the rest of the day, this has been addressed several times. I think new studies should contain the contents of jet fuel, so they're doing experiments, collecting contents of jet fuel, sampling maybe, investigate contrails by sampling. The studies that I've shown in your films were quite interesting. I think we should do that all over the world if we want to get a very big matrix about what is going on everywhere and try to relate it with your observations by making photographs, by videos, etc. And then we can extrapolate all these data into a big matrix about what is going on. And of course, witness accounts. I think, what Peter is doing here with the possibilities that the Belgium law system has in potential is to drop a complaint with the judge, who is then obliged to investigate. And I hope that you will get your answers soon, of course. If people ask me, why are you, as an academic from an esteemed university, speaking on conferences like this, is because I keep telling you that there shouldn't be any taboos in discussions when people are concerned about things. And there are many more subjects that should be and must be discussed And I think, Peter, compliments to you and your organization to stand up and do that, because I think the future sky should look like this. Thank you very much.